Welcome everyone on this rather chilly November afternoon to the third event in this fall's Environmental Humanities series. Please do keep an eye out for our spring events, which include the author Elizabeth Rush and Carolyn Finney. We also have a regular Environmental Humanities reading group that meets to read new and core texts in the Environmental Humanities. And we're gonna drop information about that into the chat. And in general, you can find out more about the Environmental Humanities at Brown Initiative on our website, which is very graciously hosted by the Kogut Institute for the Humanities. Which brings me to the really key task of thanking everyone at the Kogut, Traude, Lisa, Gregory, Mike from Media Services, who make these events possible, and to the Kogut for their ongoing support of this initiative, which has been really critical over the last several years and is allowing for us to provide an increasingly robust and dynamic set of programs for the campus community going forward. It is my very deep pleasure to now introduce today's speaker, Jedediah Purdy. Jed is joining us from Columbia Law School, where his teaching focuses on constitutional law, legal and political theory, and the environment. And these issues are also at the heart of his truly prolific and wide-ranging public writings. Jed is, to me, truly a model of a citizen scholar who participates in a variety of conversations about the environment, the future of democracy, and how we should understand ourselves as citizens in a more than human world. His most recent book, This Land is Our Land, The Struggle for a New Commonwealth, explores how the land has historically both united and divided Americans, and how the environmental politics of land use has always been twinned with issues of distribution and justice, and offers a way of understanding humanity as an infrastructure species. His previous book, which came out not very long before This Land is Our Land, called After Nature, A Politics for the Anthropocene, traced the long history of environmental law as a central feature of American political and cultural life. It's one that I assign in my classes all the time, as it's a kind of a primer to the ways in which legal ideas shape how it is that we interact with landscape. His other books, which is an intimidating list, since it seems to take me a decade to write one, include For Common Things, Irony, Trust, and Commitment in America Today, The Meaning of Property, Freedom, Community, and the Legal Imagination, and A Tolerable Anarchy, Rebels, Reactionaries, and the Making of American Freedom. His legal scholarship has appeared in publications from Yale Law Journal, the Harvard Law Review, the University of Chicago Law Review, to the Duke Law Journal, and the Ecology Law Quarterly, among others. But it's also very possible that you know his work from his frequent essays on topics ranging from socialism to natural disasters, to the Green New Deal, to Elena Ferrante, which appear regularly in publications, including the Atlantic Monthly, the New York Times, and the New Yorker, among many others. He's also a contributing editor of the American Prospect and serves on the editorial board of Dissent. It's my very great pleasure to welcome Jed this afternoon. And if you have questions during the course of the talk, you can use the Q&A function at the bottom of the Zoom screen, and we'll be kind of collating those at the end of the talk for a Q&A. So once again, Jed, thank you and welcome to Brown.
Bathsheba, thank you so much. Really generous introduction. And I do want to say before I forget that Floating Coast, your first book, I believe, was well worth a decade if that's what you spent on it. It is both a trenchant work of environmental historical scholarship and also the kind of book that you give relatives at holidays. And I have the receipts, as they say, to show that we've done that in my house. I also want to thank everyone who has helped to make this event happen, including Gregory and Lisa and Mike and others. Really appreciate the work. My topic is a question: is climate democracy possible? Maybe possible is too strong. Maybe I should have said likely. Or have asked something like, how far are we from it? That cluster of questions is what I'm about to speak to. So to begin, please join me in imagining four history textbooks in the year 2050. Each one tells a different story that could be our future. They all explain that the 2020s began as a decade of crisis, plagued by a broken climate, deep inequality, civic animosity, and doubts about whether democratic politics could help or was itself part of the problem. In these decades, the books recall, people around the world asked whether democracy had already failed, whether the climate was already irremediably broken. They blinked at the future and they wondered who would save them. The first textbook tells how strong men saved us, or saved some of us. Their enemies called them nationalists, populists, and bullies, and they were very happy to play the part. Some of their supporters felt that politics had already become a joke, a charade, whose only point was to keep well-connected insiders comfortable. They wanted leaders who talked straight, even especially if they caused some offense or alarm. In Poland and Hungary and Brazil and the United States and elsewhere, these strongmen served their clans, partisan and ethnic. They treated the country as the property of the right kinds of people, and sometimes they looked after those people. Sometimes they left them to take their chances with pandemics, climate change, and a global capitalism that the strongmen sometimes decried, but somehow never actually challenged. Popular loyalty survived these tests of faith. The strong men and women, soon enough, did what it took to make sure that only their favorite candidates won elections. In fact, this came to be what democracy meant. Donald Trump Jr.'s supporters chanted, "Defend our democracy," in November 2032, as they mobbed the offices of election boards across the country. After that, the history books explain, everyone understood that there's nothing sacred about getting more votes. Note, the Electoral College had laid the groundwork for this ethno-constitutionalist view by handing victory to the popular vote loser in the years 2000, 2016, and 2028. The point was for the right people to win. After some years of struggle, they did. The years from roughly 1965, when the Voting Rights Act began to free the franchise from Jim Crow, and the Hart-Celler Act ended the longstanding quota system that had restricted mass immigration to white Europeans, from 1965 to 2024, are remembered in this history, except among dwindling dissenters, as a failed experiment in political equality and cosmopolitanism. 2016 is remembered as the beginning of the end of the insider elite that inhabited universities, the professions, nonprofits, democratic political staffs, and legacy media. As the century wears on, the climate denial of the 2010s morphs into the doctrine of resource sovereignty. It's our right and duty, declares a joint statement of purpose issued by an axis of strongman powers, to secure the conditions of survival for our people and for our children's children. This is not a matter of politics, but of life itself. The second history book tells how experts saved us. In this story, politicians couldn't solve the climate crisis. Their thinking was narrow and short-term, and their constituents combined those limitations with flat-out ignorance and fantasy. Fortunately, the central bankers of the rich countries teamed up with technologists to create a sweeping innovation agenda that halfway saved the planet and was also very profitable. They even shaped their program to soften racial and regional inequality, likening it to a new New Deal that was greener and more inclusive than the first one. Some would-be strongmen politicians railed against the bankers and technologists, but the balance of public opinion was for solving problems, and the strongmen faded because they had no solutions. Other politicians practically bowed to the experts, who couldn't be bothered to return the courtesy. As often as not, the experts looked over the heads of the politicians to social movements such as climate protesters, saying, "This is beyond politics. Our children's children are calling on us to defend life itself." Everyone understood that the experts, the engineers, and the very rich had done what needed doing and the governments had not. Their success put politics in its place as a sideshow. In hindsight, the first decades of the 21st century with a time when a new global constitution grew in response to crises that traditional politics couldn't master. Historians explain that the emergency measures that central bankers took to avoid complete economic meltdown in 2008-09 and to keep economies stable during the pandemic that began in 2020 were premonitions of a new regime built on an old principle, that the legitimate ruler is whoever can keep us safe. The COVID pandemic also showed, historians later relate, that it's madness to trust questions of life and death, which have scientific answers, to the whims of voters, especially voters who, given the chance, might choose strongmen. So elections continue, but the most important decisions are beyond the scope of politics. Who gets to create money? Whose debts or other assets get purchased by the Federal Reserve and cognate institutions? Who can cross borders? The textbooks tell how, in the early decades of the 21st century, people of goodwill realized that democracy doesn't mean that majorities rule. It means a rational system of governance that shows concern and respect for every member of the society. If some stakeholders, a term that has replaced the antique sounding citizens, see it differently, their supervisors will still take their interests, their real interests, seriously, and hope their children will see things more rationally. The third set of textbooks are a mess of clashing stories and lessons. In this future, no one saved us. There's endless quarrel over where to lay the blame for the failure. Every country has its own version of the great decline that began in 2016. Here's the American one in capsule. In some election years after 2020, waves of enthusiasm swept the cities or the countryside or both. Partisans girded up to save the country from the other side. Sometimes they also had a program to restore it or to make it truly great for the first time. But the filibuster, the Supreme Court, the Electoral College, and social media all did their work, and every river of reform was lost in a great swampy delta of institutional vetoes and impassioned popular resistance. Historians agree that the signal facts of the early 21st century were the two presidential elections that Republican presidents won in 2000 and 2016 without popular majorities, the Supreme Court's 6-3 Republican majority after only one Republican president had won the popular vote between 1992 and 2020, and the persistent belief among partisans that the 2020 election was stolen. These were all recognized in hindsight as symptoms of a growing democratic sclerosis. As it slouched toward 2050, the country remained divided between what were in effect two minority parties. The right-wing one unable to win popular majorities, the center-left one unable to get control of a national government that was skewed to small and rural states. Neither party able to change much besides reversing each other's regulatory policies. After a nationalist Republican won the Electoral College and lost the popular vote and entered the White House in 2028, California's governor announced that their state would no longer recognize federal authority over certain matters, including immigration. 4 years later, the woman whom many expected to be Texas's last Republican governor reciprocated amid claims that the Democratic president-elect had won by fraud. Talk of secession migrated from region to region, depending which party dominated in Washington. Meanwhile, the planet heated up and more people died in each decade of storms, heat waves, and crop failure. In 2050, those who have the means stock up on what they hope will let them survive real breakdown. For some, that means guns and solar arrays. For others, second and even third passports. Those who don't have the means hunker down and cultivate relationships with their neighbors whose help they expect to need. Mutual aid studies becomes a major field in the remaining schools of public policy. And a book called Dancing in the Ruins is a bestseller in what is called, for reasons no one recalls, Blue America. In Red America, which has its own bestseller list, Joy in the End Times is riding high on the bestseller lists. In international airports, Americans off to shop for real estate in New Zealand, past Chinese returning from doing the same in British Columbia. Depending where you are, your history textbooks will give you one story or another of how the Great Decline got started. These three futures are already with us. The strongman scenario doesn't need much elaboration. The experts save us future is a little less in the headlines. But two of the most important and creative political acts of the 21st century so far are the massive debt purchase payments that central banks launched between the economic near collapse of 2008-09 and the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic in 2020. The show of ingenuity and power in a time when hobbled and inept governments were not able to act with the same alacrity or effectiveness has prompted a range of commentators to urge that the institutions that are able to govern should do it. In 2020, the historian and interpreter of global economics, Adam Tooze, argued in Foreign Policy that it's time to give our financial and monetary system a new constitutional purpose to address environmental crises, inequality, and slow growth. And in 2021, the Financial Times commissioned Kim Stanley Robinson, a beloved science fiction author and a self-described democratic socialist, to write an essay urging what he called carbon quantitative easing, in which central banks would effectively finance a Green New Deal. Both Tooze and Robinson took pains to say that their proposals would need democratic authorization, but the logic of events may call for more. If voters and elected officials can't get their act together, will institutions that have the capacity to do something go ahead and take political silence or cacophony as a form of authorization? Should they? After all, the alternative might be the third scenario, a political system amplifying its own dysfunction in a world that cannot afford inaction. The fourth history book tells how we saved ourselves, how in the early 21st century, democratic citizens overcame impasses and addressed crises. This one's the hardest to forecast, and unfortunately, I'm going to keep talking mostly about what stands in its way, because we have to understand what we're up against, which begins by thinking of the crisis of climate and the crisis of democracy at the same time, together. In the rest of this talk, I'm going to set out a series of ways that the crisis of democracy makes the climate crisis worse and vice versa. And then I'm going to say just a few words about what might be involved in overcoming them jointly. My little narratives presuppose that we have an overlapping sense of what the crisis of democracy is, but let me say a little more. Besides a name for a series of election results that alarmed many of us, the term crisis of democracy gathers together doubts about whether the countries that political scientists used to call established or consolidated democracies can achieve three things that any political regime must if it's to succeed in governing. First, it has to make clear who is in charge, who has authority to make decisions and confront crises. Second, it has to generate decisions to match its crises, has to be able to produce laws and executive actions and so on, not be caught in gridlock. Third, it must be able to govern or rule pronouncements that will be ignored or thwarted, even if they have the nominal force of law, are just tweets. Disputes over the legitimacy and the vote totals of elections make it harder to say who is in charge and harder to make a decision stick. That is, they challenge both the first and third criteria. Legislative gridlock makes lawmaking hard or impossible, the second, and our Constitution is set up as a kind of anti-politics machine, making legislation difficult. All of this pushes decisions to the White House, and the authority of the president to act is especially subject both to partisan suspicion and to judicial erosion. The alternative is often no action at all. Running through all of this is a flavor of polarization in which rule by the other side feels basically intolerable, a kind of polarization that favors a constant crisis of governability. So, with that rough working definition of what I mean to name by the crisis of democracy, the question whether democracy can produce and implement responses to the crises that beset us, I'm now going to name, as I said, a set of reasons to think that it is even worse than it looks at the intersection of democracy and climate crisis. First of these is a reversal among scales of time. Let me say what I mean. Ecological and even geological time has speeded up. Global carbon dioxide levels have risen as much since George H.W. Bush launched the first US invasion of Iraq in 1990 as they had in all human history up to Bush's inauguration. For undergraduates, that is ancient history, maybe. For me, old but not that old, this means that I first marched against US war in the Middle East, something many of us have done since, in a world that was more climatically different from today than it was from the time of ancient Babylon or the first Chinese empires. Secular political time has generally been premised on a stable natural backdrop. People act in the world and the world abides. For much of Renaissance and early modern politics, political time was envisioned as cyclical. The rise and fall of regimes was set against the natural world that was basically constant and, for political, if not for theological purposes, eternal. Since the 19th century, a progressive view of political time in which freedom and equality and prosperity grow from decade to decade has been set against the backdrop of, not opposed to, but has been at home with, a view of the natural world as a resilient cornucopia that rewards and sustains human innovation. There have been, of course, prominent doubts about this picture of the relation between politics and the world, between political time and ecological time, for more than a century, even more so in the 50 years since the flowering of modern environmental politics. But today, ecological time outpaces political time and generates crises faster than we can grapple with them. Outside of war, democracies have generally worked on the premise that they had time and had time on their side. Now it's ever easier to conclude that we don't have time. If there's a scale of time that promises to keep up with ecological time, it may be technological time, the pace of innovation, whether for geoengineering, renewable energy sources, big batteries, whatever. But technological innovation generates its own questions. Who controls geoengineering? Who's responsible for its global side effects? Which versions do we use? Who benefits economically from new energy sources? What happens to those who don't? If technology somehow succeeds in keeping pace with ecological crisis, that might well be because it breaks free of politics in the rule of expert scenario that I described earlier, or in more rogue undertakings like a solo geoengineering project by the next Elon Musk, where all the questions of distribution and accountability just fall where they may. So, this role of technological time as the one thing that unsettlingly might keep up with ecological time when political time has fallen behind because ecological and geological time has become faster, gets us to our second theme, which is something I've written about before and have called the weight of the world. Let me give you a few facts to specify what I have in mind. According to responsible estimates, for every person on the planet, there are some 2,000 tons of built environment, such as roads, houses, cargo ships. Between 2000 and 2020, global energy use rose about 50%, most of it from fossil fuels, despite growing recognition of the climate emergency. These facts are related because very little in our personal 2,000 tons of infrastructure is neutral when it comes to energy. As individuals, and so as a species, everything we do, survive, communicate, work, play, agitate, taps into this vast infrastructure with specific consequences for the energy our day will require. On the margins, my personal energy use makes some difference. But in the round, my energy use is like breathing. I have some control of the pace and tone, but the basic chemical metabolism is the condition of everything else I do. So climate politics demands remaking the vast exoskeleton that organizes our activity and our energy use. The Canadian scientist Václav Smil estimates that major energy transitions tend to take 50 to 100 years as old systems give way to new ones. under the Paris Accords, we're aiming to do much of it in 10 years. To get to net zero by 2050, we need to shift the weight of the world in a way whose price tag is often estimated these days at $100 trillion. Excuse me. I beg your pardon, I'm getting over a 3-week cold. Of course, a figure that size projected over 30 years can only be a magnitude estimate, just a stab at getting the scale right. But it's huge, the scale is huge. Official explainers tend to say things like, because that spending has to be economically justified, because a lot of it will be private capital, policy has to follow and clear the way, which is an oblique way of saying that the shift won't happen without very basic political decisions about spending on research and industrial policy, about rules of accounting, about capital movement, about regional development planning, about foreign aid. Frankly, our conventional categories strain to capture the sweep of what we're discussing. But these challenges are not specific to democracy. They're burdens on politics across the board, but they interact with democratic crisis in a way that may make both sides of the problem harder. My third reason for worry is that the crisis of democracy is specifically a crisis of democratic faith. The climate crisis makes it undeniable that the stakes of political action are very high. We need ways of shifting the world on its foundations. But just at the moment when we see this imperative clearly, there's also widespread doubt that democratic politics is capable of delivering what we need from it. The 2020 presidential election, to return to that moment, saw the highest turnout in a century, but voters' motives were, in a way, essentially defensive. About 90% of partisans on both sides said they doubted the country could survive in its present form if the other side won. The signal experience of politics now is often fear of being ruled by the wrong subset of fellow citizens, fear that for the other side to be in charge is tyranny per se, fear of national political immolation in the next election crisis. Our culture, maybe more accurately our skein of subcultures, has become intensely political in the sense of fostering strong partisan identification and intense attention to the personalities in the White House and Congress, but it's also deeply anti-political in a different sense, in the lack of confidence in the constructive power of political action. At least when we're considering the other side, we tend to agree with the canonical skeptic of democracy, Walter Lippmann, who said about 100 years ago, a public is inexpert in its curiosity, discerns only gross distinctions, is slow to be aroused, quickly diverted, it personalizes whatever it considers, it's interested only when events have been melodramatized, awkward word, into a conflict. Should we put our faith there? Will we? This political disaffection or crisis of democratic faith, my third worry, worsens a fourth problem, the fourth worry, which I want to call to fix ideas the paradox of planning. What I mean by the paradox of planning is this: when a government takes explicit responsibility for giving shape to economic life, which is what it means to undertake an energy transition, for example, it makes itself politically answerable for everyday burdens and disappointments. Fuel prices, job crunches, the price of meat become political problems for the party in power. We see this, for instance, in the salience of fuel prices in US politics right now, when climate politics is in the air, compared to 2008, when the price of oil went much higher, but it wasn't seen as being so closely connected with partisan programs. We see it too in the French Gilets Jaunes, the yellow vest movement, a major thorn in the side of power for years now, inspired by a rise in gasoline taxes. Climate change and energy transitions treat a lot of economic life as a political problem. They have to. I've been arguing some of the reasons that they have to. This has given them a certain appeal for some on the left, because they seem to force recognition that the economy is thoroughly political. But by the same token, they put every economic trade-off on the agenda of political grievance. when the defining political emotion is already the feeling that the other side's political power is intolerable, expanding the agenda of political power may create insurmountable political barriers. The more we do what we have to do, the harder it may be to do, because it will be appropriately understood as political, but to be political will be to be vulnerable to counter-mobilization and disaffection and undermining. Because dealing with explicitly political questions is such a challenge in the way I've just described, it's more convenient for architects of power to work through anti-politics. Let me define that term. Anti-politics is a form of politics that takes certain questions about how to use public and state power off the table of public decision. It hands over areas of what might be, or in principle should be, political life to ideas about how things have to be, how they just are. Here's one example. In 1998, Bill Clinton, then president, argued that trying to change the direction of market-led globalization was, quoting, like trying to stop the tide or the wind. In 2005, Tony Blair, the former prime minister of Britain, said that arguing about globalization was, again, quoting, like arguing over whether winter should follow summer. These are rhetorical fragments of a whole worldview of enormous power in the 1990s and 2010s, the decade that made our world. That worldview treated market life as basically neutral, natural, and cast government in the role of helping markets to thrive by supporting them on the one hand and getting out of their way on the other. Under that way of thinking traveled everything from the financial deregulation of the late 1990s that did so much to contribute to the last financial crisis, to complacency about economic inequality and the rise of the new internet monopolies, to China's accession to the World Trade Organization. It would be very convenient to be able to update this anti-politics as a pro-climate program, because it's a way out of the gridlock and thickets of politics. That's what self-consciously mainstream climate advocates are doing when they talk about the need to get the accounting of greenhouse gas costs right, so that policy can help financial markets to do the right thing. Markets are basically natural. They're basically trying to do the right thing. They just need to be helped along. The way needs to be facilitated. But I'm afraid that the cat is out of the bag, that climate policy is sure to be climate politics, partly because its critics are going to make sure it is, partly because there are actually very good intellectual reasons to believe that it is. The basis, as I said before, of the appeal to many on the left of climate politics in principle as an acknowledgement of the political character of economic ordering. And here, I'm afraid, the legacy of decades of anti-politics around the economy is unfortunately going to help to make the baseline of the current energy market seem natural, and whatever changes it seem political. So the paradox of planning that necessary energy transition decisions are easier to oppose, harder to act on because they're brought into the field of politics, is made worse by the legacy of anti-politics, the habit of treating a certain market trajectory of political economy as being not political at all. Clinton and Blair, it's just like the seasons, it's just like the weather, the market. It might have been better preparation for a political fight over the energy transition if we had been having explicit fights all along about the terms of globalization, monetary policy, the internet economy, and so forth. But that's not the history of the last few decades. And so both our legacy of depoliticization and our current dynamics of politicization of economic life, I think, represent challenges to a democratic grappling with the climate crisis. So to return to the scenarios that I set out at the beginning, the climate crisis seems to favor a deepening of democratic crisis. The most plausible scenarios for the next 30 years or so run either to failing to grapple with the climate crisis, failure that seems likely to confirm standard criticisms of democracy as being selfish, short-term, more driven by emotion than by reason, or to run to successes that also knock down democracy, such as showing that the real power to govern rationally and humanely lies with non-political institutions, nominally non-political institutions, and the experts who run them. If we relax the boundaries of my three scenarios and allow them to run together a little, the likely shape of the next few decades looks like a long slog of doing less than we need to do, acting but failing to meet announced goals, and spurring distributional fights around the results of each substantial but insufficient move. These prospects of dysfunction upon dysfunction are especially disheartening because, in an ideal sense, the questions the climate crisis presents are quintessentially political ones that a democracy could hope to answer in terms of the equality of everyone involved. The questions include how we're going to live together, what kinds of work our economy rewards, what kinds of lives it fosters, how we shape the larger living world. At the limit, the questions include who lives and who dies in the 21st century. What happens at the meeting place of democratic crisis and climate crisis seems likely to be seen as proof that democracy doesn't work. This is especially regrettable because what's often called the crisis of American democracy is not the result of too much democracy, but of too little. Too few Americans are able to vote, and those who do vote are prevented from ruling. The national majority that voted for Hillary Clinton in 2016 was thwarted by the antiquated Electoral College, which is prescribed by the Constitution. The national majority that elected a Congress to expand Medicaid to the working poor in 2010 was thwarted by five Supreme Court justices who ruled in 2012 that the means of funding the expansion was unconstitutional. Here in 2021, national majorities that support paid parental leave and public support for childcare are being thwarted in the Senate, where identical representation for each state gives disproportionate power to older and more rural and whiter voters, and so on, in a polarized country. These are partisan examples, partly because the Republican Party is presently a minoritarian party adapted to an anti-majoritarian political system. But tens of millions of Donald Trump's supporters voted to express their own version of the perception that, as a pair of political scientists put it in 2014, under most circumstances, the preferences of the vast majority of Americans appear to have essentially no impact on which policies the government does or doesn't adopt. The pathologies of contemporary politics, angry partisan clannishness, overheated elections combined with weary doubt that government can do anything, are not evidence that democracy is failing, so much as they are symptoms of our failure to be democratic in the first place, or so it seems to me. It also seems to me that the way forward would have two branches. One would be a Green New Deal, whether or not called by that name, that gave a share in public prosperity to people of many walks of life and many regions. And second, a constitutional refounding that established genuine political equality, actually universal voting rights for everyone who's making their lives here, regardless of criminal record, citizenship status, and other distinctions, and the power for national majorities to set the country's direction, shaking loose the many arcane barriers of our constitutional structure. In this political season, both of those prospects seem almost utopian. The most comfort I can find for them is to remember that history really is surprising, that new things really do happen, for better and for worse. That is what I have to set up the rest of our conversation today. I will stop and hand it back to Bathsheba, I take it.
Yes, thank you so much for that, Jed, and thank you for joining us on the tail end of this cold, which I feel like everybody I know has right now. it's no fun. If folks have questions, if you can drop them in the Q&A in the bottom of your Zoom screen, please do. I certainly have some and will take the host's prerogative, I guess, of asking the first one, which is a question about the ways in which we think about time, which came up in your talk and in ways that really interest me, temporality being a preoccupation of mine too, I think. And I was interested if you had thoughts about ways to preserve some of the aspects of the linear thinking that you brought up, and particularly the ways in which the ability to kind of imagine a linear progression of time is often associated with the ability to imagine a better world, right? It's associated with calls for justice and improved lives for people in a variety of ways.
Yes, an arc, if not a straight
line. Right, an arc, if not a straight line, right?
Lots of squiggles, but if you step back far enough, you can.
That's right, you can zoom out from your messy graph. But I feel like particularly in the post-war Western world and the global North, that's been predominantly associated with economic growth simultaneously. And you can maybe argue that it goes further back. And I wondered if you had thoughts about ways of kind of decoupling the necessity of imagining a better world from one that is also so associated with GDP, basically.
Yeah. So that's so the last turn in what you say is so interesting. So what I found really generative in some of the political thinking that the Green New Deal conversation helped to prompt, including the great little book called, I think, A Planet to Win, which Alyssa Battistani co-authored with a couple of others, including Kay Aronoff, Thea Ria Franco, so I think is around Providence, is the way that it highlighted that we need to bring the measure of prosperity itself back into politics, mm-hmm. and make new decisions about how we're going to assess prosperity, which is to say, in a way, what economic value is going even to be. GDP has so many famous internal distortions. It counts caring for elder, doesn't count caring for elders at home, but counts hiring private security, for example. Conventionally ignores drawdown of economic resources. Lots of other such things will have been in your mind as you make the point. And it also does, as a standard for progress, probably put us on a collision course with planetary carrying capacities, as they say. Certainly at some point, even if the question where is disputed. And so this is why I thought the fantastic argument of the Green New Deal case was that we might not have enough planet for all of us to have private prosperity, but we may have enough planet for all of us to have shared public prosperity. And maybe that means not all driving our own cars around. Maybe it means more parks and fewer big lawns. You can sort of imagine it and spell it out in lots of different ways. So you need to, I guess, to sort of put it back in terms of the arc, the image of the arc of time, you need to have a kind of politics about where we're headed, about what counts as forward motion. And that, I think, is one way of bridging the distance that you're talking about, that in a sense, we continue to need an idea of progress, but the idea of progress that we're working under is in key ways that we've inherited is in key ways part of the problem. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that. So David Frank asks a question, and one that I feel like comes up in my classes quite often, related to your idea of the paradox of planning. And he asks, how can climate activists repoliticize status quo market arrangements around energy, food, transportation, et cetera, to address the kinds of asymmetries that you discussed?
I'm interested in your thoughts and David Frank's thoughts, actually, about that. I mean, I have a very schematic thought, which is that policies that acknowledge and try to shift the ways that lawmaking and policy shape economic order, which is always true. We don't always see it and we don't always say it, but it's always true. Need to create constituencies. Policies succeed and stick and people fight for them when the policies have beneficiaries who understand themselves to be beneficiaries and organize and fight accordingly. We see this in some probably at this point perverse examples like the Farm Bill. We see it at most of what the Farm Bill does, at least. We see it in Social Security. We see it in, maybe more interestingly politically, in the intense mobilizations and fights to save the Medicaid, the Obamacare Medicaid expansion in red states like Kentucky, once people understand that this is their healthcare. It seemed ironic, and a lot of people laughed at it when a Tea Party person said or had that sign that said, "Keep your government hands off my Medicare." But there was something very powerful about "keep your Republican hands off my Medicaid." I mean, that's if you see it that way, then it feels more constructive. People will fight for what they understand themselves to have won. But I also think it's incredibly hard once people understand that, to come back to that example, that the price of commodity crops or the price of food is not, sometimes it's driven by the weather, sometimes it's like the weather, but if it's not like the weather, it's something you can get agitated about, then everyone who's in the mix will be fighting, and then it is actually very hard to move established interests off their starting point. So what I'm trying to say is that, and I think this may be built into David's question, and in that case, the question is a very, very deep one, which I think is really hard to find a way through. It's the closest you can come to overcoming the asymmetry is where the asymmetry that, let's say, favors established beneficiaries and established regimes is by creating counter constituencies within your reform regimes right away as fast as possible. But I think that the most that does is come close to evening the playing ground. The difficulty, I think, in the paradox of planning can't be easily overcome.
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you, David.
That really is. Thank you.
Meg has a question about the relationship between sort of democratic practice and expertise, which I is another one that I feel like comes up frequently in discussion of climate and of COVID and of a variety of other things, and asks a concern about the disconnect between expertise and the public are compelling, but current debates about vaccination seem to suggest that we have to develop a relationship of trust with those considered to be experts. What are some ways that democratic citizens can relate positively to expertise?
Yeah, so this is such an important question. It's undoubtedly a signal pathology of politics right now that experts as a sort of idea, expertise as a slogan, and also certain populations of experts, like public health people in particular, have been drawn willy-nilly into a style of polarization in which, as soon as anything pops up into view, it's assigned to one, it's anathema to someone, and the opposite to the other side. And this is really bad. This is really bad because you could say there are two extreme kinds of relations to fact that will both wreck a democracy. One extreme, which we've learned a lot about in some ways in the, what I think of as the long 1990s, from like 1989 to about 2008 or 2011, is facts it's forms of expertise, like neoclassical economics, for example, being given the status of policy science so that they become a kind of anti-politics, and most of politics is just about adhering to a program that's written into that kind of ostensibly empirical and objective discipline. That's one pole that leaves politics with nothing to do. And also, I think, in the case of neoclassical economics, put us on the path to crises that contributed to our current difficulties, particularly the financial crisis. The other pole is failure to respect empirics, failure to respect reality in the framing of political fights, a kind of treatment of facts as basically optional and as tools for triggering reactive political emotions and defining affinity and anathema. So you asked how, and I'm stating what I think is baked into your question, which is why it's important for democratic publics to have positive relations to expertise. I wish I knew. I'm working with some people at Columbia who are trying to think about that. I hope they're going to come up with some insights. I'll be quite candid with you. I think it's really, really hard in the face of the politicization of vaccination and COVID to see a straightforward way back. At one time, I think I would have said, oh, well, it's easy to say, I don't trust this kind of expert or that kind of expert. But when the chips are down in our own lives, we listen to people who know more than we do. But that's actually not clear. Now people are willing to put their own lives and the lives of elders and children and their family and their families on the line. So I think there's an enormous amount of work to do here. I do think that we have to, for what it's worth, bear in mind that hostility to expertise, skepticism of expertise, is not all just irrational and ill-motivated. A lot of experts from the rationalizers of the first Iraq invasion, and well, especially the second Iraq invasion, the theorists of financial deregulation have steered us pretty wrong. People have lived through what the political economist Will Davies calls a lot of expert lies. And so the grounds for disaffection are pretty widespread, and they're not all pathological. But I guess I just have to say, and here I'll stop. I agree this is something we very much need. We need institutions and we need civil society forms that foster a respectful sense of fact. And I think we're all kind of struggling with a crisis in that domain.
Yeah, that's a hard question to
definitely
answer. As a historian, I just get to talk about how the facts get eroded. I have the easier job. So Zario, and I hope I'm pronouncing your name right, has a question about whether or not there's kind of a Sophie's choice implied in the framing of your talk between the kind of first two scenarios, which involve the sort of ability to save Earth more or less as we know it, versus saving democracy is the third choice. Saying that, we hope we can keep both Earth and democracy, but in your view, is this choice kind of coming? And if so, how would it come about?
So I guess I do see the expert save us scenario as one in which people who have the responsibility to the capacity to act come to believe, I think with great moral plausibility, that they have the responsibility to act and that democratic authorization is not worth waiting for. So I guess I see that choice as one. The question is sort of, will actors who have the capacity to make it believe themselves to be confronting it and go ahead and act on it? And I think it's not an out of the question scenario. How we avoid it, I think, by trying to save both at the same time is, to my mind, in a way that I acknowledged at the end, feels utopian right now in this particular fall tumbling into winter, is by strengthening democracy and recognizing that what's failing in this country, at least, and where this country's politics go, is very important to where the world goes in this issue as on others. Excuse me. The failures aren't exactly democratic failures. The failures are, in a bunch of ways, the failures of a system that advertises itself as democratic, but it actually is not a system of general enfranchisement or majority rule. And a lot of the specific pathologies of our political culture are part of and fostered by one party's having crafted a minority rule strategy for itself of a kind that our constitutional institutions allow it to translate into control of government. So I think, I guess the best I have to say is we should not believe that the crisis of democracy is exactly a crisis of democracy. It's a crisis of the political failure of democracy, at least in the versions we've seen. And it is not out of the reach of democratic decisions to produce a picture of a future of shared public or shared common prosperity. It's hard to see how the next 2 years get us closer to that, but it is not at all beyond the scale of what a politics can do. It's in some ways the kind of thing that that we've done before with even more deeply flawed democratic systems than we have now, which I think is why the hearkening back to the New Deal is valuable, because that was, for all its appropriately notorious limitations, a system of really remaking political economy in a way that generated new majorities that lasted for decades because they were dealt into a new version of prosperity that responded to the crises of the time.
So I think we have time for one more question, and I'm going to ask a question that Mark has in the chat, kind of combined with my own question, because I think in some ways they go together, and it has to do with the kind of frames through which we imagine politics. Mark asks whether or not part of the challenge that we face in this particularly polarized moment in the United States has to do with kind of collaborative politics and the capacity to create coalitions in a world where that seems like a distant memory of the long 1990s more than a kind of present fact. And I wondered about this also. I recently read Andreas Malm's book, How to Blow Up a Pipeline, and then Adam Tooze has a really excellent review kind of Malm's whole kind of recent, incredibly prolific series of books. And part of what both Malm and Tooze are pointing toward is a question of whether or not the New Deal and the post-World War II political moment is actually the one that we're in when it comes to climate politics, or if that kind of rule of experts, society of great material plenty in the global north, is not the right kind of metaphor. And it's also a moment of very collaborative politics in the US, which is my very tenuous tie to Mark's question. But instead, if the political moment we're in, given the urgency of the climate crisis, looks closer to the revolutionary 1920s, and the kind of insurrectionist vanguard movements around the world, who kind of went out ahead of the democracy. We have a squirrel situation. Can't tell. I'm gonna leave it there because my dog is loud.
That was amazing. Do I have anything around? I don't have anything in my office that's comparably fantastic. I guess I think that it's not a theoretical, but a historical question, that maybe that's a confusing way to put it. Whether we're in a New Deal style situation, which is a way of asking, are we living under political institutions and in conditions where the capacity exists in principle to remake political economy in a majoritarian way, is not a question whose answer we can know in advance. it's a process, part of the process of our own self-interpretation, which is always practical as well as empirical. That is, it's always about figuring out what we're going to try to do and what we think are what we think we're up against. That's not to say we can't make rational assessments of what we're up against. And I do think, and I think this is part of what lends itself to the current interest in Malm's ecological Leninism, as Adam Tooze called it in his review, is the assessment that we're up against more reasons for pessimism about majoritarian remaking of political economy getting off the ground than was the case in the early mid-1930s. And I've been talking about some of those reasons for pessimism. I guess, so that's a sort of negative part of the analogy. That is, the question is, are we not in the New Deal? There are some reasons to think we might not be. I think, much more skeptical of the idea that we're in a moment when vanguardist movements are actually going to have a kind of chance to move state power or take state power in ways that was the kind of defining experience of Leninist politics. So that as it were, positive part of the analogy seems to me a lot harder to establish. I don't think the nature of our states, among other things, is such that they can be taken by vanguards in quite that way. They're too diffuse and multiplicitous. And the kind of, even the deeply flawed norms of majoritarian endorsement are still very, very, very powerful. It's hard to build legitimacy as a vanguardist movement. So I tend to see the vanguardist parts of climate politics as involved in a sort of tricky, though not always subtle, kind of legitimation dance with official decision makers, probably including technocratic kinds of decision makers. And that was what I was trying to gesture at when I described in my little scenario the experts saying, reaching over the head of politicians and of mass publics and basically quoting Greta back to the publics and saying, our children's children are telling us that this is what we have to do. This is not about politics. This is about life itself. That seems to me the much more, I think that political role for vanguardist movements is inevitable, and it is not the same as majoritarianism. I don't think that's their only role, but I don't expect to see them playing a Leninist role in the sort of history-making sense that the analogy of the 20s throws up. Who knows, though? Who knows? I don't know.
I really appreciate your point about not being able to tell what's going to work until it's worked, which as a historian who sometimes is asked to speculate on the future without a crystal ball, I feel very deeply.
Past is hard enough, right?
It's just hard enough. Thank you, Jed, so much for joining us this afternoon and taking time out of your busy life and away from your wonderful two-year-old. And on the behalf of everyone who joined today, really, it was a real treat.
Thank you, Bathsheba. It's great to see you. And thanks, everyone.